I came to GCC when I was 18 after studying for a year abroad in Spain, where I did a lot of traveling to Morocco and Germany and all over Spain, and came back with the thoughts that I would study photography and anthropology and work for National Geographic and be like a famous journalist. And so I started taking classes with Tom Young and became an art student. That time here, I spent 3 years here in the art department, and that was a really important time for me. I did a lot of exploration. We had printmaking department then. I spent a lot of time in down in the print studio, and the painting room was also the drawing studio. And a big part of my time here was not the time in classes, but the time outside of class on the weekends and at night with fellow students. We'd just go in there, bring some music in, and we would just work on our own. And in fact, that's how I got into painting. I actually never took a painting class. After graduating GCC, I rented a studio and I kept painting, and then I transferred to the San Francisco Art Institute. Out there, I still didn't take a painting class. I was still gravitated towards the printmaking studio. I should say that at that time, my first child was born. I moved back here and again rented a studio and then spent the next 5 years painting. I mostly painted oil on canvas. What had happened is during the schooling, you do a lot of exploration, and I think it's the perfect time to put your fingers in a little bit of everything. So that's what I felt like I had done, a little bit of printmaking, a little bit of film, a little sculpture, some painting, and I just wanted to stick with one thing and settle into it and get to know the material and let that material kind of guide me. And so I chose oil on canvas, stuck with that while I was waiting tables. My second child was born during that time, so the time in the studio changed. I wasn't somebody who could go in, work all day, go home, and then work in my sketchbook all night. It really just, I had to set up some sort of discipline. At some point during my late nights waiting tables, I said I have to make a change, and I decided to go to graduate school. And I don't even know how graduate school came about. Graduate school was something that wasn't even in my vocabulary. I think I just had happened to meet somebody, knew that if I wanted to teach at college level, which I started thinking that might be my only way to be an artist and not wait tables. And so I ended up going to the University of Massachusetts grad program for fine arts and chose painting. Graduate school is just a treasure. It's just a treat. It's a time to go in and just, they give you a studio, you're surrounded by an automatic community, a network of fellow artists. It's just a super vital time. It's also, again, a time to explore, and you have all these resources at hand. I started painting, I moved into drawing, I did a little bit more printmaking, and your third year is your thesis year. So in September, you meet with your committee. You choose your own committee. And you sit down and they say, okay, so what are you gonna do? And here's your date for exhibiting. So you have an exhibit and you defend your thesis. I had a few things happen. I was pregnant with my third child. In some ways, and I mention that because that's an anchoring for me. It really sets up your constraints in a way. You have to make work now. You know, you just don't have a choice. There's no, oh, maybe I'll do it later, or maybe I'll do it tonight, okay? So for me, that's been great discipline, and not so much an obstacle, but I would say the opposite of whatever an obstacle is, kind of the momentum. okay, having that kind of criteria set out for me. I had a few things happen. During my first 2 years, I had explored pretty intensely the milagro, which means miracle. It's a Latin American kind of like an amulet or a charm or a offering, something that if you had a part of you that might be ailing, or you're a farmer and your cow is ailing, you might buy one of these little offerings outside of a church or on the street and bring it to the church, and it would be a symbol of the ailment. So it might be an arm if you had a hurt arm, or a cow if your cow is sick, or a breast. There's a lot of breasts for the breast cancer. So I started becoming really interested in creating these offerings on a personal level. And I did a lot, and what they do is they're these little tiny silver or metal offerings, and you hang them on a little nail, and so they kind of move. They have a little hole on the top. So it's something sort of decorative. Around this time, I also had visited the Butterfly Museum, and the curator there was just happened to be in that closet changing the cocoons. Each one was on a pin. And as the butterfly emerged, there'd be an empty cocoon, and that cocoon would have to be taken away and discarded. And therefore, he would be able to move to make these nice, neat rows of, in categories according to what kind of butterflies they were. That, for me, said something about flexibility. And that's something I've always been searching for. And I should say that previously, and I could almost say that since the beginning of my time painting, when I started having children, my work has always had this overarching theme of developing some sort of balancing act. Sometimes that's been expressed through a narrative. Sometimes it's been expressed through the organization of my painting or drawing. But I'd say that's something I'm always searching for, and it's not in a symmetrical sense, but searching for some kind of balance. And when I'm saying, I'm trying to balance all my interests, really. Everything that I want to do, and try to still be a good person. So that was prelude to that thesis year. I had the interest in the milagro, which means I had started coming off the wall. So my drawings had started getting cut out and pinned to the wall. Things were starting to move a little bit more freely and without. You always have the horizon, you always have the vertical. Okay, and we always are working within that kind of structure. Whether you take away the paper, then you have the wall. It's just a bigger space. But for me, I felt like the wall was more of a direct experience. It also took away the hassle of building stretchers or even buying paper. I liked the immediacy of it, and that was something I always was searching for. And it's something that you might find in your sketchbook. I'm a big advocate of using your sketchbook in that kind of automatic process that goes on in your sketchbook, that when you try to recreate it in more formal means, it's difficult. So for me, one way to get that automatic process going was to directly use the wall. So at this time, I started using the pins and cutting out my little drawings. I started getting more interested in watercolor. I was influenced by Richard Yard, who's a great watercolorist and professor at UMass. So sitting down with my thesis advisor, still totally clueless. I was lucky that I had a lot of things on my desk. I started looking a little bit more closely. I also was really lucky that I had a dream that I feel like kind of told me what to do. It was a dream of a painting that I had made when I was about 5 or 6. Mom or dad, I don't know who, they chose to, I remember making this declaration after I made the drawing. And I was sitting on a, I can remember the bedspread made by my grandmother. It had red and white polka dots on one side, embroidery on the other side. And I had my new box of crayons and my nice big piece of manila paper. And I made this abstract egg kind of thing. I went out into the living room and said, I'm going to be an artist when I grow up. And so they framed it, and it always hung in our house. When they got divorced or something, where we moved or something happened, the drawing disappeared. And then I had this dream about it that first month of thesis year. I went and found the drawing, and I brought it to the studio, and I felt like it had some answers for me about maintaining a playfulness, about just making art and not getting all hung up with, you know, this is about immortality, and this is about childhood memories, and this is about this. And it was mostly about trusting yourself, that it's in you and you want to do it, and you just have to put the pen to the paper, okay? It was a sort of liberation in a way, and a reminder as it hung on the wall. So that's where I'm going to start. And that was a bit, you know, I had kind of done some installation work, but I felt like things really started to gel at this point. And I felt like those were my ingredients. The dream of this childhood drawing, which I was actually able to retrieve, the idea of the Milagro, and the real life stuff of everything that's going on, maintaining that balance in my family, in my art career, my relationship with my husband, and everything else that there is. So yeah, that was a lot to all pull off and put together into one piece. I wasn't just picking one aspect. I really wanted it all to get kind of married together and start to tell me something. The objects that were on my desk are things that I have collected or picked up and saved. They're kind of personal artifacts. And I felt like something that I've always had, you know, are little things in your windowsill or a little altar next in your studio, or, you know, why do you save certain things? And I felt like there might be some answers in those things. So I started to look at them more closely, draw them, and rearrange them. And I think the major scope of my work is trying to figure out how it all fits together, which is basically trying to figure out who you are, right? Trying to figure out your identity in a sense, which I could say that almost all work is autobiographical, whether we're looking at the outside world. Here's the world with all the stuff, whether it's physical, spiritual, okay? And then there's the filter. And I think here's the artist as the filter. And the stuff is going through the filter, and then there's the art. At the same way, and this is something I tell my students, the world is over here with our the process that we take in observation. And then there's the filter as we engage in the process. And then there's the end product, which is the art on the wall, or the music that is made, or the dance that has been performed. And then we reflect. We often go back and engage again, observe again, and it's not one, two, three. But I talk about those three things a lot, okay? Where I'm going to start is to show you what happened, the result of that thesis year, and then move forward. This was the thesis exhibition in Herder Gallery. The wall is 33 feet long, about 9.5 feet tall. I did this all in my studio. I had two walls with a doorway in between. I drew on the wall with the pens and the cutout shapes and the found objects. And then I had to bring it over here and reassemble it. It took me about 5 days to put it on the wall with a little bit of help from different folks. The nice part is it changed as I put it up again. And I had expected that and hoped for that, that there'd be some change. These are some details. On the right, those red kind of straight looking things are red twist ties. Underneath The yellow pieces are watercolor on paper. The kind of big oval in the middle are pussy willows, which are individually pinned. And the top are black alderberries, which are dried and pinned. And the bottom, those are birch cut out, dried mushrooms. And the ellipses that move through are those accumulated objects or small drawings, combination of the watercolor and the found objects. So you can see how the shadow works on the wall, which wasn't something I was able to control in the studio and something I had to work with in that space with the lighting. That's watercolor, and those are small. And those are based after geranium petals. So as I was looking closely, I was collecting ideas for forms and forms that started to resonate with me. And I just heard the other day an interview with an author, and I'm sorry, I can't remember his name, but he said, "I read what I write so that I can see what I think." And I think that's often true, is that we look at our work afterwards to see how it made sense, to see what how it speaks to us and what it has to tell us. And that's not always true for every artist, but I definitely work that way. I'd rather make the work first and figure out what it's about afterward. I collect a lot of rocks. Those are watercolor on paper forms, on the left there, but they're based after the shapes of rocks. And I think they happen to look like a spliced rock. I was really interested in identification books, and one book in particular, an old book that I have, is about ferns. And on the right, I documented all the little vascular bundles on the different ferns, and those are the little green watercolors on the right, and turkey mushrooms on the bottom. I spend a lot of time going out in the woods. If I have a studio day, I always go out in the woods and take a walk. I collect things. Mica became a big thing that I collected. This is a close-up of that same installation. This is found mica, mica that we chipped off of rocks, found on the ground, and luckily was able to stick a pin through. Curly birch, watercolor, twist ties from your junk drawer. If any of you shop at Greenfield's Market, you get the red twist ties and they accumulate in your drawer. And I think one day I happened to put a twist tie next to a red piece of wax from a piece of Gouda cheese and just loved how they spoke to each other. And I'm not kidding, but that's a big part of how this happened, is what happened when you put things next to each other. And that's what I said, is how do things fit together?
I don't see pins in the middle of those. How are they actually, you know, the whole...
The bigger objects, like the yellow pieces, there's about three or four pins on the outside of each one.
Okay, holding it.
Yep, and it comes off the wall about an inch. So this wall had been painted a million times and was a real bitch to get into. So I bent a lot of pins. I had to search for the right pin. I finally found them down in New York, a pin company that deals with artists, actually. You can find everything in New York. Here's the pussy willows. In this piece, you can kind of see on its side, kind of in the center near the bottom, there's like a silhouette of a rabbit. My work was definitely more symbolic, more narrative, and some of that carries through. And I think as my installations have progressed, I've been losing some of that literalness. This piece in particular carried some of my symbols that I had been using in my drawings, in my paintings. There's a little sketch in there, kind of halfway, midway up, and on the bottom, it's just a little piece of paper. It says Supermom, and it has like this little figure flying. My work was definitely more figurative, and on the bottom you see kind of an animal shape, like a crocodile in green, near the birch. Those definitely started disappearing, and the forms started taking their place. I don't know if I can say exactly why, because sometimes I miss that. But I guess I felt like I don't need it as much to say the same thing. I guess I've been able to say, finding that I can say the same thing by juxtaposing shapes and colors next to each other and textures. And sometimes texture alone can speak the same language as a crocodile can. I graduated from UMass. I was still pregnant, waiting for Toby to be born, and knew that at that point I could say that would be an obstacle in continuing my direction, and felt like I just needed to send my slides out everywhere. And so I made all these nice little black packages with my slides and my cover letter and my resume, and just sent them to all these places, hoping to get another deadline, basically. I was afraid of not having a deadline. And because I knew family life could take over too easily. So what happened was Toby was born, and he was, I think, 6 weeks old, and the curator from the De Cordova Museum called me and said, oh, I want to come out for a studio visit. Well, of course, with a six-week-old, you know, I definitely wasn't in the studio. And I said, well, I'll do whatever it takes. I'll just stay up all night. But he was up all night. It just, there was no way. And so I ended up having to call her back, which was one of the hardest things I've ever done. I called her back and told her, I said, actually, I have three kids. I just have a new baby. This is just not the best time, but if I'm going to lose the opportunity, come anyway. And I literally had nothing on the walls, nothing. And since that thesis piece was a temporary piece, it, when it comes down, it's in boxes, there's, you know, she had seen the slides. There wasn't anything else I could show her. I felt convinced, though, that I still wanted to be working in that, with those same materials. She was great. She is actually from this area. She said, fine, I'll come at the end of the summer. And so I was like, okay. I think that was June, so she was coming in August. And I think she ended up coming in September. So I bought myself some time, and what I did is started creating, trying to work the same way. I just started playing on the wall, putting things next to each other, hoping for some magic to happen. And this is what I had in my studio. This is a shot in the museum, but in my studio, I built this on the wall. It's about 10 feet tall and maybe 7 feet approximately wide. I had a lot of community support, and that's important for me. I had people collecting things. And at this point, through the collecting process, you know, I had run out of stuff in my desk and my little treasure boxes, so I couldn't just use stuff around the house. I had to go out and search for it. So I had a kind of rule for myself that it had to be something ambiguous, because I feel like when you're walking along and you see something on the ground and you're not sure what it is, then you start to wonder. Okay, and you want to pick it up and you want to see what it is, but there might be people around, you know, it might be a used condom, but it's still a beautiful object, right? And so that became the rule, is that you had to wonder about it, and that made you pick it up. And then you had to pick it up. That was the second part of it. So everybody started helping me. People would go on vacation and they'd bring back a Ziploc bag full of stuff and say, does this fit? I didn't know what this was, you know, and it would be like piece of a buoy, you know, or a piece of a claw from the beach. People started getting it, and it was really a lot of fun in a way that I can say I've never experienced in the studio making art before. It started to involve people collecting their soap ends for me, mom helping me cut out these rocks. I painted all these watercolor rocks, which I needed a certain number, which was in the thousands. People were collecting mica for me. it became a big collaboration. And then every night I would go up and I'd pin to the wall and try to make it fit into something. I realized that, and this is the, there was three of these, and they're based after the idea of a midden, M-I-D-D-E-N, which has several meanings, but the one that I was using was that of a kind of cultural findings that are often found in the bottom of a old foundation or a refuge heap. So artifacts from culture, and in this case that are not recognizable at first glance, but become recognizable as you move closer and look a little longer. So in the center, and they ended up being referred to as the giant egg, when it was upstairs in the studio, it was the big egg. Is the egg almost finished? And it kind of takes that on as this information that's encapsulated inside something. Although watercolor is real translucent and light, it seemed real solid in this form. And the same with the mica, that vein of energy kind of running through the rocks. That's the mica. This is a 50-foot wall, about 14 feet high. So when the curator came to the studio, I had the one on the right in the studio. And I have a small space. It seemed really kind of imposing. You could get right up to it. You couldn't get that far away from it. It definitely had a different feeling than it has here. And she said, what do you want to do? Why don't you come out to the museum and pick your space, tell me what you want to do. So I had made a little watercolor study, and that's what I wanted to tell you, is that each time that I dream up an installation, as the installation starts to form on the wall by throwing pieces together, I make these studies. And that's what these are about, these watercolor studies. I don't know what the next one will materialize like, but somewhere over there I think are some clues. So I told the curator I want to make three of these large forms on the wall. And the big problem was how would I install it? So it did. It took 8 days, about 80 hours of pinning, some carpal tunnel, and my sister flew out and helped me for those 8 days. And I had it pretty well planned out. Everything was packed accordingly. I had templates for the forms. It just had to work. It just had to happen, and it happened right at 5 on the last day. No, the second two I didn't assemble. I just made the templates and then did the math of how many pieces do I need, and plus 20% just in case. So there's about 60,000 pins. I did count this time. So that's what the middle looked like. And it still takes on that idea of the milagro, of kind of elevating the mundane object for it to take on something more spiritual. And I used the mica, and up close you can see that surrounding each object as a kind of outline or its own little altarpiece, I hole punched mica, and I had to buy this mica in big sheets, and I hole punched it and made these little sequins. So the whole thing kind of had like this glittery effect to it, which I think helped draw people closer and look a little bit longer. And I think it also helped to elevate these objects, which are normally trash, to something more sacred and to find the beauty in them. After that, I had a show at down at Brown University, and this little gallery that it would only be a 4-week show. I wasn't about to do an 8-day installation process for a 4-week show. It just didn't make sense. And so I said, well, let's see if I can kind of translate what I was doing to painting and still maintain that fluidity of flexibility of working directly on the wall. This is the painting I made. It's three different scrolls. The whole thing totals about 12 feet wide by 8.5 feet tall. And so, you know, like, just like the mica was running through as a sort of pathway around the outside, these white dots are kind of playing with that negative space, but running through this painting as kind of a path through this chaos. This is watercolor. Yeah, watercolor on paper. This piece I did this year in the Fitchburg Art Museum. This one's called Wandering Balance. That previous one, the watercolor painting, was called Continuous Reconciliation. And the one before that with the three middens was called Slices of Life. This one, Wandering Balance, is really just that. It's kind of that ebb and flow and that I wanted to capture, of the kind of the stepping stones that we take that kind of slip and slide from underneath us. And I'm going to bring you a little closer, and the red arrows kind of guiding us along, keeping us on track. So it's a little bit more literal of our pace, of the pace that I'm using. This was partially assembled in the studio, planned out on paper mostly because of time, collected the materials, pinned them in the studio, brought them on site, and this took about five days to install because of how dense it was. Yeah.
Kind of mind-boggling to me, and then of course I'm taking the tokens down, obviously with an understanding of the
right
wall and separate boxes.
I do. Yeah. I do. These have become characters. They've basically become my palette, in a sense. And some things, once I use once and I'm done with it, I don't want to see it anymore. Other things, I still feel an attachment to. Sometimes it's because I haven't collected enough of it and have just used a little bit of it. The kind of pastel colors up near the top, those are soap ends. I'm still collecting those. Everybody, save your soap ends. That's a community project. Those are just precious to me for some reason. And kind of work in the same way like a watercolor, kind of unpredictable how that the end product's gonna turn out. Below that, you'll see in the top right is the mica, in which I still reuse the mica. The arrows are new to this piece. So under the soap ends, that's a kind of bark. And then the little mica sequins are under that. And then the black alderberry. The pink is the watercolor based on the geranium. And then oak galls, which I still collect a lot of those. More mica, more rocks. I still hang on to the rocks. In fact, whenever I'm feeling really ungrounded, I go for a walk and I literally get down and I start playing with rocks. It's just something that I've always done. It's just one of those grounding experiences for me, so it keeps coming back. The moonwort, or the silver dollar plant, is in there, and the little flotsam and jetsam, unfortunately, from the beach, the little plastic pieces found on the ocean at the beach. This is the last piece that I just took down. This was at the Brattleboro Museum. And this was a really tough piece to come by because it was a hallway space. It was about 15 feet long, 8 feet tall. And you really couldn't get back from it. And I had been working with this idea of macro, micro, needing to be able, the piece needs to work from far away, and then it needs to work from up close. So this piece, you couldn't get back, but you could walk by. In fact, mostly you'd be walking by. So that was my biggest consideration, was how to kind of anchor folks there. Literally, you had to be almost in front of the bathrooms to be looking at it this way. This piece evolved in a similar way, except that a new element was added. The top pieces are small drawings on paper with marker and watercolor. The arrows are coming out in from the sides. Those bigger red arrows are painted directly on the wall. And that kind of bottom loop is our found objects. And then the mica helps fit everything together. So So in the top there, and I'm just going to go forward again, this is a close-up of what's going on in the top. And these are all small paintings. And these forms are based on the found objects that were in the studio. And then there's a kind of gradual gradation from the painting to the found objects, where it gets a little bit thinner. And then that's it. Whoops, so I'm just going to turn this off. Right.
You could have had the choice, of course, of putting it on, not showing the pins, but the pins are so much of it. Is that why?
It's how you described it as being a specimen, or the idea of the milagro, like what I was talking about before. If the pin was glued on, there wouldn't be any movement. The other thing that happens when you walk up close to one of these things is there's a slight movement with your breath on it. And things are small, delicate, real intricate, and so people are close. And so just the breath moves, say that moonwort, that becomes another layer for the senses. Right. No, that's a really good question, because I think during my last 13 years of being a mom, I've come across so many people who have said, oh, I'm too busy to make art anymore. You know, the kids have gotten taken over. And I feel like there's part of me, which I don't know if this is a healthy thing, but I've just wanted to prove, not only to myself, which I think there's a biggest thing, I am probably proving it to myself, but proving it to mostly women who have children, is you can do it if you just want to do it. And maybe something is starting to shift for me with that, but I think there is that going way over the top and making sure that the process is revealed with these pieces. Right, it did the except the thing that you have to remember is that I can sit down and cut out 10 rocks at the dinner table, right? You know, this is piecemeal. I can do 10 rocks, or I could have 2 hours and do 30 rocks. So that did become really important, having things kind of mosaic style that you could start to move around and fit together. And if you had 5 minutes, I could still be doing something. And the collecting process could be happening when I'm not in the studio, when I'm walking across the parking lot. And then I felt like I always had my hand in it. Maybe it's just a metaphor for accumulating responsibilities. Yeah. So I think that's it, unless you have more questions. That's probably the most common question. Building it on something that could be portable. It's really fragile when it's on the wall, and it would be fragile, built, if it was all pinned onto a piece of wood, everything would fall towards the back, and I'd still have to handle it and adjust it. I guess I'm not super interested in that. I've played with that so much, and I haven't found a solution, and mostly because of the seam that would happen of putting something on the wall. I like the directness of the wall, so the minute that I build it on something and put that on the wall, there's a seam. I might as well make a painting, in a sense.
I just really appreciate the personal aspect that you're sharing. And to me, looking at it, because of all the labor that's in it, and how long it's taken me, it's just an intricate detail that is a very personal thing in some way, and so you're trying to recognize that.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I feel like, you know, I'm not really shy in that way. I feel like maybe that I want to give something at the same time, and I guess that's something I struggle with being in, wanting so much time in the studio. It's a selfish activity. There's no kind of ways about it, and I think maybe in a sense this is me giving back, and that goes to that idea of the milagro and the offering in a sense, and what Budge talked about with beauty, that I feel like I want the optimism to be there, and the way that I create that is that shimmering kind of let's draw you in with something beautiful, so that's an important aspect to it.